I get this all the time. Hey, I saw your video, but then I saw this other video and it said the exact opposite. So who do I trust? Easy. You don't. Science isn't based on trust. It's based on confirmation. Or as we say in nerd speak, reproducibility. Of course, this is completely understandable. We don't have the time to go read 100 studies every time we gotta make a decision. So we look for somebody who's gonna give us the answers. Somebody we can trust. Problem is, if I don't know much about a topic, then I don't know enough to know who's right and who's wrong. If I know enough to fact check the experts, I don't need an expert. But if I need an expert because I don't know enough, then I don't know enough to know who's an expert. So we all do the same thing. We use shortcuts, like the vibe we get from the person, or professional titles, or how popular they seem. But we greatly overestimate how good our judgment really is. Research has shown our brain makes snap judgments that subconsciously guide our decisions. Would you trust this man? How about this one? Or this one? These faces might look similar, but psychologists found subjects responded differently, implicitly trusting the picture on the right the most. This effect was so strong that even after telling the volunteers about a history of untrustworthiness for that individual, facial features still influenced how much they trusted him. We also tend to trust people who just look like others who were reliable in the past, and vice versa. We tend to mistrust people who look like others who screwed us over. Psychologists have shown we even trust people more if they look like us. Maybe this was advantageous to our ancestors. People who look like me are more likely to be my relatives. So if my entire world is a tribe of 100 people, this might help a bit. But nowadays, interacting with thousands of people on the internet, this is a disaster waiting to happen. Credentials and degrees, those are really tricky too. Just spend 5 minutes on the internet. You'll find a bunch of MDs saying the exact opposite on a factual claim. So somebody's got to be wrong, which means the title is no guarantee of anything. And needless to say, going by personality, likability, charm, who seems honest, who says it like it is, massive pitfalls. Somebody can be 100% sincere and 100% wrong. Basically, the trick is to focus less on the individuals and more on the concepts or the ideas. Less on the who, more on the what. This is very unnatural to us because our brains want to do the exact opposite. So we're going to give you a framework. We're going to look at three major red flags, the three A's to avoid. And after that, we're going to look at three tips that actually do work to distinguish reliable sources. The three P's. P for positive. And yes, these rules apply to me as well, of course. And you should hold me and everybody else to the same criteria. Okay, so here are the red flags, the three A's. First A is an over-reliance on anecdotes. We're wired to connect with anecdotes. They just resonate with us. Bar graphs and p-values, not so much. But anecdotes are notoriously unreliable. They involve many variables. There's placebo effect. There's the lack of a control group. You name it. It's a mess. So you want to be careful with arguments that rely heavily on anecdotes. And nobody's immune to it. We actually released a video on salt recently. And I talked about a salt substitute. And I showed some studies showing effectiveness. And then I mentioned that I got the same salt substitute and my blood pressure went down and some family members. And an attentive viewer wrote in and he said, that was an anecdote in the middle of that video. And I thought about it. I looked at it. And you know what? He's right. So we went back. We deleted that. We deleted that segment where I made that statement. So if you go watch the version of the video that's live, that sentence is now gone. Not that it's the end of the world to mention an anecdote, as long as we're not basing a scientific argument on it. And especially if we mention the limitations, right? But I thought the viewer made a valid point, and I thought the video was probably stronger without that remark. And also, if we're criticizing and trying to set the bar high, we gotta be ready to take some criticism as well and walk the walk. So that got cut. I just realized that whole story was basically an anecdote. So I ragged on anecdotes by using an anecdote. Yep. We're doomed. Okay, the second A stands for antagonism. We've all seen different online communities or people sometimes whose entire worldview is us versus them. Our diet A is perfect, and those guys over there with diet B are all a bunch of morons. And the third A stands for anger. We want to avoid coming at this from a place of frustration, crystallized in this very common idea of they lied to us. They being sometimes the government, sometimes scientific establishment, sometimes the status quo, etc. So This, the antagonism, fighting everybody who has a different opinion, and the anger, this is not a good headspace to look at things objectively and just try to figure stuff out. It more likely warps our perspective and blinds us. Now, we all make mistakes. Nobody's perfect. We all have our moments of weakness. So the idea here is not to point fingers, but you're looking for a pattern, right? A pattern of calm and objectivity and curiosity, or a pattern of antagonism and anger and frustration at another group or groups. And on that note, let's keep it positive and look at the three P's. And I should mention, I came up with this jointly with Simon Hill from the Proof podcast, and we actually broke this down in more detail in a recent episode that I was on with him, and I'll link that below. But this is the gist, right? This is the 1 or 2 minute summary. Just the juice. First P stands for proof. The burden of proof lies with the person making the claims. Now, this seems obvious. It's almost like a duh, right? But you'd be surprised. I get messages all the time from people who say, I'm really confused by this blog or this podcast. And it turns out it's just a bunch of claims with zero evidence. You don't need to be confused by just claims. There's something called Hitchens' razor, named after the writer Christopher Hitchens. That which can be asserted without evidence can be dismissed without evidence. So if it's unaccompanied by evidence, yeah, you can just move on. This rules out 90% of internet confusion. I saw this really interesting comment the other day by one of the viewers, one of you guys. He said, hey, really interesting videos, really thought-provoking, but I'm not sure because you guys keep saying stuff that doesn't really match what the other YouTubers are saying. Yeah, that's the whole reason we make these videos. The whole reason I started making these 3 or 4 years ago, whatever it was that you look at systematically at the scientific evidence and you see one thing, and then you look at the internet and you see wild claims. Sometimes it's the exact opposite. So point is, worry less about what people say and worry more about the evidence they show. Yes, including me. Okay, second P stands for preponderance. Strong scientific arguments are based on a body of evidence as opposed to isolated studies. We've all heard this type of argument. There's a study for every idea out there. They have theirs over there, and I have my own studies that support my view. This is social media bickering, right? Tussling. But a serious scientific approach looks at all available evidence, and it strives for a model that reconciles everything. So if I want to figure things out, I look at the full picture. But if I just want to prove my point that the picture is red, then I just focus on the corner I like. And finally, the 3P stands for pyramid. Pyramid refers to the hierarchy of evidence. All evidence is not created equal. So you want to watch out for claims based on mouse data or a tribe somewhere in the Amazon, what's called ecological data. These are the weakest forms of evidence, the lowest rungs of the pyramid. The mouse data is pretty self-explanatory. It doesn't tell us what happens in humans. What about looking at a specific population? That's humans. Why is that weak data? Let me give you an example. People ask me this all the time. Hey, in Japan, they eat this food a lot, and they're pretty healthy over there. Doesn't that prove that that food is good or bad in some other examples? France has a very high rate of smoking. Over a third of French people smoke, and yet it has one of the highest life expectancies in the world. When we look at a country on the opposite end of the spectrum, in Nigeria, less than 5% of people smoke, and yet it has one of the worst life expectancies in the world. When we put it like that, every single one of you can immediately see through that argument, right? It doesn't mean that smoking makes you live longer. It means that these cross-country comparisons involve thousands of moving pieces of confounders, right? From genetic differences to culture, to quality of healthcare, to overall quality of life in that country. This is why you want to focus on the upper rungs of the pyramid. Evidence in humans, well-designed, reasonably matched groups, and where you make an effort to isolate a variable, either by randomizing the participants or by adjusting for the differences. That means well-designed cohort studies, randomized clinical trials, and finally, meta-analyses. Meta-analyses also help you get at preponderance, the second P, because they give you a snapshot of the big picture. So this information gives you a simple and an actionable framework. If you hear somebody making claims and there's no evidence, you spot it. If the evidence is in mice or rats and the claim is for humans, you spot it. If the evidence is in a tribe somewhere in an island, boom, you spot it. right? And you're always looking for evidence higher up that pyramid. All right, hope that helps. And as always, let me know your thoughts below. And we got a lot of exciting videos coming out, from gut health to questions about protein to effects of food on mental health, all kinds of fascinating stuff. So stay tuned. Take care. See you on the next one. Bye-bye.